Okay, the next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 11319 in the name of Kenneth Gibson on lifting the £50 million charity cap. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, but I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Kenneth Gibson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have secured today's members' debate on the pressing need for the UK Government to lift a £50 million cap on charity lottery funding. And I thank those SNP, Conservative and Labour members who supported my motion to enable today's debate to take place. Although lotteries policy is reserved, this issue impacts greatly on charity policy, which of course devolved, and on many charities based in Scotland. Despite existing to fund charities and good causes rather than to make private profit, charity lotteries are the only type of gambling or fundraising to have a cap on their sales. To illustrate the absurdity of this situation, figures released by the Gambling Commission show the total revenue going to UK gambling firms in the last financial year was a staggering £10.9 billion, excluding reported lotteries. It's now virtually impossible to attend or watch a football match without being bombarded by every conceivable type of gambling advert. According to University of Glasgow researcher Dr. Robin Ireland, a single English Premier League game between Newcastle and Wolves, both of which have gambling sponsors, resulted in 716 gambling exposures over the course of the game. As MSPs, the vast majority of us will have seen firsthand how devastating problem gambling can be for individuals, their families and indeed whole communities. Online betting, gaming machines and betting shops are all commonly cited sources of debt and despair for problem gamblers. Charity lotteries are not. And yet, as things stand under the 2005 UK Gambling Act, it's only charity lotteries that are subject to an annual cap on sales. The cap serves no purpose other than to place an artificial ceiling on an important fundraising stream for charities and good causes doing phenomenal work in, for example, my Cunningham North constituency, across Scotland and indeed England, Wales and Northern Ireland too. The reason why charity lottery sales limits exist at all is unclear. The only stakeholder opposition to raising the limit came from Camelot, who until today held the licence to run the National Lottery. The company's opposition came from a desire to diminish competition to the National Lottery. However, this notion has been thoroughly debunked. Evidence has consistently shown that they complement rather than compete with the unique position of the National Lottery. A 2022 report by the UK Digital Culture, Media and Sport Committee into the future of the National Lottery found that, and I quote, "In society, lotteries play a different role from the National Lottery and do not pose a threat to its charitable giving," close quote. I know this is an issue the charity lottery sector has been struggling with for many years now, so it's heartening to have cross-party support across Scotland's Parliament for this common-sense move to free up additional charity funding for good causes at no cost to the taxpayer. I hope today's debate will send a strong message to Westminster of the long-overdue need for action. On a UK-wide basis, charity lotteries generate over £420 million per annum for charities and good causes of all sizes, and this amount is growing each year. The largest and best-known operator is, of course, Scotland's own People's Postcode Lottery. A true Scottish fundraising success story, to date, their players have raised over £1.2 billion for good causes, a scarcely believable number. Players now raise over £18 billion per month for good causes across Britain. From their central Edinburgh headquarters, they employ more than 400 people, two of whom, Nick Cook and Andrew Murray, have joined us today in the gallery, and I thank Postcode Lottery for their debate briefing. And more constituency grassroots organisations such as Arran Youth Foundation's School Holiday Programme and Lars Community First Responders have received over £250,000 of People's Postcode Lottery player funding. Only last week, four winning tickets in a Saltcoats neighbourhood resulted in six charities: the Ayrshire Community Trust, Input SCIO, the Ayrshire Breastfeeding Network, Trussell Trust Food Bank, Ayrshire Children's Services CIC, and the North Ayrshire Forum on Disability, receiving five-figure sums of funding for local projects. In respect of large national charities, Scottish-based organisations like Children First, Maggie's, and the Ellen MacArthur Cancer Trust, who operate out of Largs, are in receipt of long-term multi-million pound annual funding awards. It's clear that charity lotteries are an integral part of the charitable fundraising mix in communities up and down the country. The unrestricted nature of the funding provided only increases its importance. However, People's Postcode Lottery has raised their concerns over the current restrictive limits and how it's impacting their players' charitable giving. As things stand, four of the 20 trusts administered by People's Postcode Lottery have had to take action to ensure they didn't breach the £50 million annual sales cap, a figure that does not rise with inflation. That means that these trusts will not be able to increase the amount of funds to the good causes they support, even if ticket sales continue to increase. 10 postcode trusts are set to be within 3% of the legal sales limit in 2024, meaning a larger funding gap and a growing number of charities that will be affected. The current £50 million sales cap came into effect in July 2020, well short of the £100 million identified as the UK Government's preferred option in their 2018 consultation, and one they have since stated they remain sympathetic towards. Due to high inflation and the cost of living crisis we're experiencing, this is effectively a real terms funding cut for these charities year on year. £50 million today represents a 17.4% decrease in real terms from when the cap was lifted in 2020. And People's Postcode Lottery have highlighted charities likely to be affected by annual sales caps going forward, as well as the individual amount they are projected to lose on out over the next 5 years, 24-28, without removal of significant reforms to the annual sales limit. And I'm not going to mention the dozens and dozens of these the People's Postcode Lottery have got available on their website, but I'll just mention some. Dogs Trust, £4.9 million. British Red Cross, £4.9 million. Save the Children, £4.5 million. Breast Cancer Now, £3.6 million. Royal National Institute for the Blind, £3.2 million. Action Against Hunger, £1.6 million. Mary's Wheels, £1.3 million. And top of the tree, Amnesty International, £5.7 million. So this problem will only grow in the years to come unless the cap is lifted, or, better still, abolished. It's also worth pointing out that in each of the 20 postcode trusts are individual Scottish charities in their own right, registered with the Office of the Scottish Charity Regulator, who have themselves backed reform in this area. Over the next 5 years, 100 supported charities will lose an estimated £175 million or more in extra funding due to the lottery cap. It's frankly disgraceful and astonishing that good causes providing services to some of society's most vulnerable people will lose out on essential funding due to an outdated and nonsensical regulation. The UK Government has a real chance to make a difference to charities by removing the charity lottery annual sales limit, and it should act now. The Scottish Government and MPs across the board, including my own wife, Patricia Gibson MP, who has raised this matter last year and most recently in the Commons on the 11th of January, all back removing this limit, which is part of the overall strategy to ensure we help the charity sector in Scotland thrive. It's also an issue I know has received support across this chamber. Successive Cabinet Secretaries for Social Justice have lobbied the Department for Digital, Culture, Media and Sport to ask the Secretary of State to remove the annual sales limit as a matter of urgency. It's astonishing it hasn't happened already, and I'm sure the Minister will touch on this in her own remarks. Presiding Officer, if the Scottish Government had the powers, it could and would remove this limit, but as it stands, it does not. I thank colleagues across the Chamber for taking the time to debate and support this important issue, and hope that the UK Government takes note of the strength of cross-party support in Scotland's Parliament for these common-sense changes, and urge the UK Government to act to remove the charity lottery fundraising cap without delay. It will cost the taxpayer nothing and be appreciated across the board. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. We now move to the open debate. I call first Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Alistair Allen. Around 4 minutes, Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank Kenneth Gibson for bringing this important matter to the Chamber for debate. There are many policy disagreements across this Chamber on a day-to-day basis, but it is encouraging that the issue of charity lottery funding does not appear to be one of them. After all, it seems clear that the needless and outdated bureaucracy is holding back the fundraising of Britain's charity lotteries. As has been noted, the sector raises almost £500 million in funding each year, with analysis showing that with the correct regulatory reforms, it could generate greater funding still. As regards the UK Government, I think it's only fair to acknowledge that UK ministers did partially reform charity lottery annual sales limit to the tune of, at the turn of the decade, to the present £50 million gap. However, this also only failed to acknowledge that this fell short of their own preferred option to raise the limit to £100 million, something they have promised and failed to deliver upon. Given the time that has now passed, the most sensible course of action is that advocated by the sector itself to remove the annual sales cap in its entirety. Removing the cap would future-proof the sector and would avoid the need for the government to continually have to revisit the matter, which I think is in nobody's interest. I'm pleased that Scottish Conservatives continue to advocate for this important reform, including Douglas Ross, who has made representations both to the Department of Culture, Media and Sport and to the Chancellor of Exchequer. Given that the People's Postcode Lottery analysis demonstrates that removing the annual sales limit would generate over £175 million for charities over the next Parliament, it seems to be fundamentally a Conservative way to fund the third sector across the whole of the United Kingdom. To that end, I would join others and urge the Chancellor to consider such a measure for inclusion in the forthcoming spring budget. As the official regulator, the Gambling Commission is on the record as stating that it is unclear why such an annual cap exists in the first place. And with the Commission showing that sales in return to good causes from the National Lottery and charity lotteries have reached record levels in recent years, it is clear that both types of lottery can exist happily together. It will come as little surprise to colleagues that I'm not a great gambler, although I am happy to bet the minister of which football team in Edinburgh will end up higher than the other at the end of the season if he wants to give me his money. But I do think that, and I am concerned about some of the potential harmful effects of the commercial gambling and betting industry. For this reason, I think it is important to place on record that the non-for-profit charity lotteries are recognised by the UK Government, the Gambling Commission and academia as a low risk and quite distinct from the commercial gambling sector. I'm pleased that the People's Postcode Lottery is headquartered here in my region, and their game is recognised as one of the safest and worldwide gambling market by the distinguished Professor of Behaviour Addiction at Nottingham Trent University, Professor Mark Griffiths. Maggie's Cancer Centres, which does so much important work in the Lothian region, supporting those people on their cancer journey, currently receives £3 million every year from the People's Postcode Lottery. But if annual sales caps were to be lifted, it could receive an extra £5.5 million over the next UK parliamentary session. As a former Hollywood Dog of the Year winner, I will at this point declare an interest. However, the Dogs Trust, which also receives £3 million every year, would be in line to receive an almost £4 million extra funding over the next 5 years were the cap to be removed. Presiding Officer, it's impossible to deny that the third sector here in Scotland and across the entire United Kingdom faces a major challenge in regard to its funding environment. The scale of the challenge is not one that can be solved with ever greater amounts of public funding, and nor should we aspire for it to be. As a society, we are stronger when civil society can flourish, which is the case of charities means deploying their expertise to support the most vulnerable. Removing the annual cap on charity lottery sales would help better fund the third sector at no cost to the public purse. And so I am very happy to support this motion this afternoon.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. It should be noted that Mr. McLennan did not seek to intervene to pick up your gauntlet. That will not have gone unnoticed. I now call Alistair Allen to be followed by Paul O'Kane. Around 4 minutes, Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank, firstly, Kenneth Gibson for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. It focuses on a real source of funding for many charities and highlights a completely needless obstacle which many of them face. I'm a long-standing supporter of charity lotteries, which raise funds for good causes and are operated, as others have said, on a not-for-commercial gain basis. However, these lotteries are being hampered in their support for deserving causes by an unnecessary and unreasonable funding cap, which was originally implemented by the UK Government to protect the National Lottery from competition. The Gambling Commission, in its advice to the UK Government 7 years ago, stated that it believed there was no need for such a cap to remain in place, given record levels of both national lottery and charity lottery sales in recent years. During the UK Government's 2018 consultation on charity lottery limits, its preferred option, as has been mentioned, it was raising the annual sales limit to £100 million. Yet 6 years later, charity lotteries are still being constrained by a limit half that size. As Mr. Gibson points out, when they could be bringing forward legislation to free up millions of pounds of funding for good causes, the UK Government's continued lack of action on this issue is hard to fathom. Working to remove the annual sales cap is an SNP manifesto pledge and an issue which the Scottish Government has been supportive of for many years. The Scottish Government has made representations to the UK Government about this on numerous occasions, as I understand, frustratingly without progress. The legislation on the matter is, unfortunately, still fully reserved to the UK Parliament. Several of the fantastic charities based in Scotland that the People's Postcode Lottery supports, such as Maggie's Centres and Mary's Meals, are seeing their funding indefinitely capped due to the outdated charity lottery annual sales limit. And this is despite the People's Postcode Lottery's desire to increase their activity in support of charities. It's estimated that over the next 5 years, Maggie's may lose out on £5 million of additional funding, while Mary's Meals may lose out on over £1 million. During a cost-of-living crisis where charities are on the front line of providing support across the country, I have to ask, how is this fair and what end does such a cap serve? Charity lotteries have raised hundreds of thousands of pounds for good causes in my own constituency, with organisations like the Stornoway Trust, Bernera Community Association and Western Isles Foyer benefiting from vital funding. And players, as well as charities, of course, do benefit from these lotteries. When my constituents in North Uist and Bernera won £3 million through the People's Postcode Lottery, the prize was shared between 101 fortunate individuals, and this gave an economic boost to the whole community, with much of the winnings being spent locally. Charity lotteries provide transformative funding to charities, and to pick up on a theme raised by Mr Balfour, they do so in a way which deliberately does not include highly addictive forms of gambling, such as scratch cards, and charity lotteries therefore pose a very low risk of gambling-related harm to players. Presiding Officer, to conclude, these lotteries exist to fund and to support good causes. It makes no sense at all that they should face far more regulation than the purely for-profit bookmakers who make astronomical sums of money for their shareholders and pose a much higher risk of gambling-related harm. So I would urge the UK Government to break a long-standing habit and do something positive, and that would be to remove the unfair and illogical annual sales cap on charity lotteries.
Thank you, Dr Allen. And I call Paul O'Kane, followed by Stephanie Callaghan, around 4 minutes. Mr O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is a pleasure to be able to make a contribution in this debate. And let me begin by thanking Kenneth Gibson for securing the debate through his motion and indeed for his opening speech, which I think set out in detail many of the issues that I think we would all share across the chamber about why the cap feels arbitrary and unfair, and indeed why reform is so necessary, because I think he got to the very heart of talking about the difference that charity lotteries can make in communities like Cunningham North, or indeed more widely across West Scotland, which I represent. And I declare an interest, Deputy Presiding Officer, that in a previous life I had the job of setting up a charity lottery for Enable Scotland when I worked there. And I know the difference that that lottery has gone on to make, even in its kind of infancy, although not probably reaching the cap at this stage, but certainly the difference it can make in terms of the funding for charitable projects for people who have a learning disability. And I think we see that represented in the variety of different organisations who are supported, including our hospice movement very much across West Scotland, who rely on charity lotteries to support their work. And of course, we've heard already of the important work done by the People's Postcode Lottery and perhaps the limitations that have been placed upon them due to the cap. In my own local community in East Renfrewshire, I've seen funding from the People's Postcode Lottery make a real difference, and whether that be community organisations supporting older people and reducing isolation, or whether it be organisations like the Back to School Bank in East Renfrewshire, which provides new uniforms and school equipment to children, they have really benefited from funding from the People's Postcode Lottery. So it would be a real shame, and it is a real shame, that we see that this is limited by the effects of the cap which is in place. I think in the context of higher and higher demands on our third sector, and at a time when we see funds being stretched further and further, capping ability to generate funds and in turn to share funds out with organisations that vitally need it does not make, to me, any sense. Indeed, we know that analysis carried out by the People's Postcode Lottery has demonstrated that the annual sales cap on the sector restricts funding that can be provided to their 40 large charity partners. And as we've heard already, that is millions of pounds annually that could be doing more good in our communities and is currently being restricted from being raised in the first place. And I think we've already heard articulated by colleagues across the chamber today that there are a variety of different organisations who would share that view, including not least the Gambling Commission and the Charity Commission in England and Wales, and indeed, I'm sure, the Oscar here in Scotland as well. So I think it really is clear that there is consensus across this chamber in terms of lifting the cap. I think it's clear that there is also consensus in the House of Commons, and indeed I was reading the Hansard of the Westminster Hall debate that was held in July, in which Patricia Gibson and others contributed. And I was pleased, I think, to see the efforts certainly of opposition parties to come together and say that this cap needs to change, that it won't cost the taxpayer money and actually will improve charities. And indeed, in responding for the opposition, for Labour, my colleague Alex Davies-Jones called on the Minister to take action and to take a step forward in certainly getting a move on with removing the cap through consulting with the charities and organisations that are most directly impacted and finding the way to do that. I have to say that if this current UK government isn't willing to do that, then they can get out of the way and let another party come in and take this forward, because I do believe it is important and it commands, as I say, that consensus. So, conscious of time, Deputy Presiding Officer, I will leave it there. I think it's clear that there's strength of feeling in this chamber and at UK level, and it's time to do the right thing and to remove the cap. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr O'Kane. I now call Stephanie Callaghan, around 4 minutes. Ms Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm also pleased to be contributing today and congratulate my colleague Kenneth Gibson on securing the debate and calling for the removal of the annual sales limit and charity lottery fundraising. The idea that there could ever be a restriction on funds raised by the raised for the betterment of society is a bit baffling, really. Yet under the 2005 UK Gambling Act, societal lotteries are subject to that maximum sale of £50 million, as we've heard already today. And this limitation is seemingly in place to uphold the primary purpose of society lotteries, ensuring that their fundamental mission of raising funds for good causes remains intact. Yet the striking disparity emerges when you consider that other forms of gambling, particularly those that are deemed harmful, operate freely without similar constraints. So to provide some insight, the Gambling Commission reported that, excluding all the reported lotteries, the gambling industry generated an eye-watering total revenue of £10.9 billion last year, a figure already quoted by Kenneth Gibson, but certainly worth repeating. Revenue that's not only amassed by preying on society's most vulnerable, but that exacerbates issues such as homelessness, crime, fractured relationships, mental health problems, and even contributes to suicide rates, impacts that are really far-reaching and profound. Meanwhile, we impose a £50 million limit on society lotteries where there is no private profit gained and funds instead go towards organisations that diligently work to eliminate some of these very inequalities that gambling supports. And that's nothing short of ludicrous, if you ask me. So, faced with the post-pandemic era and the relentless squeeze of the cost of living crisis, charities and voluntary organisations are finding themselves grappling with a dual challenge of increasing demand while the resources are diminishing. And as a result, over half of these organisations are struggling to deliver their essential core services. And that's outlined in the Third Sector Tracker report by the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations. To put it simply, organisations are absolutely crying out for a lifeline for funding, and with society lotteries generating an impressive total of £420 million annually and displaying signs of significant growth, they are really well placed to provide this essential support. And I too welcome the representatives that are here today from the People's Postcode Lottery to the gallery. And I want to say thanks for the leading role that they've played in this campaign and their tireless efforts to remove this absurd upper limit. Reading the briefing for this debate today, it was really disheartening to learn that the existing cap on annual sales, taken over the next 5 years, will actually jeopardise a staggering £175 million in crucial funding for 100 supported charities. And it just seems to me clearly ridiculous that such a substantial contribution to charities has been seriously hindered by this outdated legislation, especially when as we've heard before, when it costs the public purse absolutely nothing. Nevertheless, community grants from the People's Postcode Lottery of £26,400 have been distributed across my own constituency of Uddingston and Bealeshill. And this support is translated into tangible benefits for various projects that affect people on the ground. And examples include funding for equipment for the Nurture in Nature initiative, and also funding awarded to View Park Gardens allotment and community gardens that allowed them to buy a range of seeds, plants, food containers and gardening tools for their Growing the Community projects. The funding has been transformational, and my team are happy to encourage and support more local organisations to apply to society lotteries. And I'm really grateful to Paula Keane for highlighting Enable Scotland as well. In closing, Presiding Officer, although lotteries policy is a reserved matter, I hope the UK Government are listening closely to today's debate and the call to remove the charity lottery fundraising cap. The growth of our community and voluntary sector and fantastic organisations is something that should be celebrated and nourished. We cannot and we should not put a limit on social good. And it really is time for the UK, I suppose in Paul's words again, to get a move on and sort it out. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Callaghan. I now call on Emma Roddick to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to firstly thank Kenneth Gibson for organising this debate on the £50 million cap placed on charity lotteries and for setting out so clearly what he described as the absurdity of this unique limit. It's lovely to have consensus today, although it's not a surprise given how ridiculous the cap is. I think the fact that we've all agreed on that really highlights how inarguably absurd the cap is, particularly when you consider, as Kenneth Gibson and Alistair Allen mentioned, these lotteries focus on the less addictive and potentially harmful forms of gambling, which are not subject to the same limit. Stephanie Callaghan was right to make mention of the fact that these charity lotteries often play a part in supporting those who are subject to the harms of gambling addiction. Charity lotteries play an important role funding thousands of good causes in Scotland, from large national charities that operate across the country to grassroots good causes focused on their local communities. In my Highlands and Islands region, charity lotteries have raised millions of pounds for local good causes such as Inverness Highlanders Junior Ice Hockey Club, Aviemore and Glenmore Community Trust and The Ledge. Charity lotteries also support large charities such as Maggie's and Guide Dogs, which have a presence across all of Scotland. And having just visited Maggie's Highlands, I know that even the smallest amount of money can make a huge difference to those that they support. Mary's Meals, which was founded in my region, has received almost £4 million from charity lotteries across the years. Valued partners of the Scottish Government, including Crisis and British Red Cross, whom I work closely with in our efforts to support asylum seekers and other new Scots, are also missing out. The Scottish Government fully supports the charity lottery annual sales cap being removed, and as Dr. Alistair Allen pointed out, we have written to the UK Government on numerous occasions about this. Simply put, it would free up more funding for charities at no cost to the taxpayer. Unfortunately for charities across Scotland, the merry-go-round of Secretaries of State at DCMS has led to this important campaign not getting the attention that it deserves. It is bizarre that the UK Tories, who are purportedly the party of scrapping red tape and regulation, have allowed this outdated and unneeded limit to remain in place for the 12 years that they have been in power. Now, I was glad to hear Jeremy Balfour on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives urge the Chancellor to take action and agree that the current limit falls short of even the preferred option from the UK Government's consultation, indeed half of it. And he is right that removing the cap would be in everybody's best interest. But unfortunately, infighting and chaos from his party down south has directly led to charities missing out on millions of pounds of essential funding at a time when it is needed more than ever. After over a decade of Tory austerity, many charities are facing incredible demand for their services, coupled with skyrocketing costs due to inflation. These charities are often filling the gaps in areas where the UK state has pulled back, and they should be given the opportunity to receive as much funding as possible. In Scotland, we have many charity lotteries, such as the People's Postcode Lottery and the Scottish Children's Lottery, who are raising millions of pounds of funding each month. And whether Paul O'Kane's Enable Lottery is currently harmed by the cap or not, I know myself the good work of Enable Scotland, and there should not be a limit on its aspiration to help as many people as possible. Players of the People's Postcode Lottery alone have raised over £1.2 billion for good causes, a truly astronomical sum of money that has made a real difference to thousands of organisations, including those in my region of the Highlands and Islands. Recently, those who've benefited have included Antalla Solish in Ullapool, which is a fantastic organisation I've had the privilege of visiting as a local MSP and in my ministerial role last year to learn about how the opportunities it offers help to address social isolation and loneliness in Ullapool, as well as tackling depopulation in the area by retaining local artists and offering those who have left the option to return. Now, they've got £18,000 from the People's Postcode Lottery last year. Transition North Ronaldsay is another group that has been supported by the People's Postcode Lottery with widespread positive effects, including their regular beach cleans, extremely beneficial community garden, and promoting sustainability throughout Orkney's Northern Isles. And they got £24,950 from the People's Postcode Lottery last year. Now, I was shocked to learn that People's Postcode Lottery figures show that dozens of charities are set to miss out on millions of pounds of funding over the next 5 years due to the current £50 million cap. To highlight just one example, Mary's Meals faces a funding shortfall of over £1.1 million over the next 5 years due to the cap. The charity sector, charity lotteries, and politicians from all political parties have been calling for further reform for some time now, and as far as I'm concerned, there is no logical reason that the outdated law should remain the same. Quite frankly, it's unclear why there is a limit in place at all, as all that it does is act as a blocker on charity lotteries' ability to fundraise. And Scotland's brilliant charities deserve to have access to the largest amount of funding possible. As Kenneth Gibson stated, we would be happy to make changes here in Scotland if we had the powers, but we do not. I and the rest of the Scottish Government will continue to push the UK Government on these limits as a matter of urgency and call for the cap to be removed. And I'm sure that many colleagues in the Chamber today will do so as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2:30.